In 1986, Andrew Lloyd Webber and Cameron Mackintosh reigned over the West End with their international mega-hits. For their latest phenomenon, Phantom of the Opera, they could now turn to a proven creative team. And for one brief moment, it even appeared that Lloyd Webber might go back into partnership with Tim Rice.
I was staying with Andrew and he played me some of the music for Phantom, which I absolutely loved. And I said, you must do this with Tim. And we'll have a reconciliation. And I arranged a dinner at Tim's home in the country. Lots of good wine. And after dinner we went into Tim's music room with an upright piano. Andrew played silence from Tim. Again, Tim speaks. The most boring music you've ever written. End of meeting.
Snubbed by Rice, Lloyd Webber first turned to Starlight lyricist Richard Stilgoe before finally settling on a complete unknown.
I'd never written a professional show. In fact, I'd never completed an entire musical. I'd written music and lyrics for about half a musical, which was submitted to a competition, a new competition at the time, called the Vivian Ellis Prize, and Andrew was one of the judges and needed a lyricist. And I was signing on. I was on the dole, you know. So it was lovely. It was a lovely surprise.
And then the tune on its own.
The reason Lloyd Webber was so particular about lyrics was that Phantom was quite literally a labour of love.
Andrew wrote The Phantom of the Opera for Sarah. Wonderful thing to be able to say, isn't it? That somebody wrote such a beautiful show out of love.
Say you love me.
You know I do.
Andrew falls in love with a soprano who can sing high D flats. Then the story of Phantom of the Opera, about this young soprano who comes from nowhere and suddenly becomes famous. I mean, there are obvious resonances in that that haven't escaped anybody in the history of the show.
Even though Phantom was written for her, director Hal Prince wasn't going to take it on Andrew's word alone that she was the right person to star in it.
I said I'd like her to audition, and Andrew said, my God, you're not asking the person I wrote it for to audition. I said, yes, and she auditioned. There were some high E's in the score. Now, you know, very difficult for any singer to hit a high E. But Sarah, that was one of Sarah's specialties. She could do that.
Sing for me.
With Sarah confirmed, Lloyd Webber next had to cast his Phantom. On earlier musicals, he had avoided star billings, but for Phantom, he changed tack.
I was in a cafe with Andrew having lunch, and the soup spoon was on its way to my mouth. And he said, I have asked Michael Crawford to play the Phantom, Gilly. And it never got to my mouth, the spoon. It went straight back down. Because like everybody, at that time, when you thought of Michael, You thought of Some Mothers Do Have 'Em.
That was a very shrewd piece of casting because it attracted a lot of media interest. It was perfectly logical because Michael had a lot of experience in musical theatre already, but was not widely known for it, so it was a slightly surprising idea. And because he's such a dedicated worker, you know, you get your money's worth with Michael.
Close your eyes and let music set you free. Only then can you belong to me.
He understood it's a very, very sexual role. He exudes weird sex, you know, slightly dark sex, but, you know, that's all the more perturbing for her, and that makes the story, actually.
Trust me, savor each sensation.
But he was thrilling to work with, and he totally understood that role.
Before we start, bear this in mind. The whole first section of this is an opera.
Yeah.
With cast complete, the task of staging such a massive spectacle as Phantom proved surprisingly straightforward.
Conventional.
It was one of the easiest shows to put together that any of us have ever worked on. I mean, compared with putting Cats together, for instance, it was a piece of cake.
Hal staged it, I think, in 3 weeks, and he only worked mornings.
I'd work from 10 to 1.
The point of no return.
Little girl in the company, one of the dancers, raised her hand and said, I've been delegated to ask you this question. And I said, what would it be? And she said, what do you do in the afternoon?
What did you do in the afternoon?
Well, I made a joke, said I see Coronation Street, but really what I did in the afternoon was wander the West End, read books, sit in Green Park.
Phantom opened in October 1986 to overwhelmingly positive reviews. The sumptuous score, fabulous setting, and the celebrity pulling power of Michael Crawford, all combining to ensure that Phantom would go on to become the most successful musical of all time.
Well, the real cachet Phantom had is that it was pre-booked for a year. You couldn't buy a ticket. So it became an incredibly sought-after thing. So by the time tickets did become available, it had sort of become a self-sustaining entity.
On New Year's Day, 1988, Phantom opened on a Broadway now totally humbled by the new breed of musical coming from the West End.
Andrew Lloyd Webber took on Broadway, returning to it the kinds of melodies and spectacles it no longer produced for itself. The story was the same in all the theatres. Some said if it wasn't for the British, there wouldn't be any more Broadway.
And it wasn't just Broadway. Phantom and its ilk have been exported to countries far beyond the twin centres of London and New York. From unpromising beginnings at the start of the 80s, in less than a decade, the West End had conquered the world.
I think it happened to be that all the talent that was really being inventive were all in Britain at that point. Simple as that, you know. And we happened to all want to do stories which had a worldwide appeal. We none of us knew that up front. We were only too grateful to get through an opening night without being stoned.
Next time on The Story of the Musical, how the giants of the West End seemed to stumble, and a new kind of musical entered the world of the theatre.